Hi. Good evening, everybody. It's a great pleasure to see so many of you here. My name is Wenny Teo, and I'm the lecturer in Modern and Contemporary Asian Art. And also, I also convene the Courtauld Contemporary Lecture Series, which is an ongoing research initiative in which we invite some of the most dynamic artists, art historians, and curators working in the field today to enter into a dialogue about their work. So please do check the Courtauld website for more information on when the next events will be. But this evening, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our two brilliant speakers, Victoria Sin and Kostas Stasinopoulos. Victoria Sin is an artist using speculative fiction within performance, moving image, writing, and print to interrupt normative processes of desire, identification, and objectification. Drawing from close personal encounters of looking and wanting, their work presents heavily constructed fantasy narratives on the often unsettling experience of the physical within the social body. Some of Victoria's recent international presentations include The Age of You at MoCA Toronto, Kiss My Genders, Hayward Gallery London, meetings on art at the 58th Biennale di Venezia, Plant Sex at the Serpentine Galleries, and these all took place in 2019 alone, so they have clearly been very busy. Victoria has also presented work at Whitechapel Gallery, the ICA, and at Tate Modern. They will be joined in discussion with Kostas Stasinopoulos, a curator and art historian who is assistant curator live programs at Serpentine Galleries in London, and associate curator at the Stavros Niarchos Foundation Cultural Center in Athens, Greece. Kostas received his PhD in history of art from the University of York in 2016, studying with Dr. Joe Eplin, and obtained his MA degree in history of art from the Courtauld, so welcome back, Kostas. He has played, of course, an instrumental role in the vibrant public schedule of live programming at the Serpentine, organizing events like park nights and numerous symposia. Kostas is also a researcher at the Center of New Media and Feminist Public Practices at the University of Thessaly. So just to let you know the kind of rundown for this evening, Kostas and Victoria will be speaking in conversation for about 45 to 50 minutes before Kostas will open the floor to questions from the audience. And please stay on for drinks, a drinks reception after, which will be taking place here in the lecture theatre. So without further ado, please welcome me in welcoming our two speakers.
Thank you so much, Lovie. Thank you for having us. Thank you for the invitation. And it's really great to be part of the Courtauld. And thankful to Victoria Sin for being here.
Thank you for having me.
And I think we are going to watch a short clip from Victoria's film practice, and then we're going to start talking.
Something alarming happened to me today. I was in a waiting room, looking through a magazine, when I came across an image of a woman who looked just like me.
So this is part one from Narrative Reflections on Looking. We can talk a little bit in a bit, but I wanted to start at the beginning and ask you how art, how did you come to art, or how art came to you?
I think it depends on like which beginning you mean and like what you mean by art. My mom was an illustrator. So it was not something that was like ever that far away, being able to engage in like like creativity or being producing drawings or exploring my creativity. I wasn't really allowed to dedicate myself to it until I moved to London when I was 18. At which point I worked as a waiter until I could screen printer, and then I also started to do drag in clubs that that I went to, clubs that I also did flyers for as an illustrator. So yeah, I did that for a while until I started studying at Camberwell and then the Royal College of Art. So I mean, it was like, yeah, it was really gradual, but I don't know, I'm still kind of coming to it in different ways. Mm-hmm. Yeah, constantly.
It's interesting because in my mind I have two questions: how you come to art, or how did art come to you? And then I was going to ask you the same about drag. But you mentioned those things as part of the same moment or series of moments?
I think that, I don't know, there was definitely an overlap when I was like going out in like the queer, like London, like nightclub scene, and I was doing flyers for lesbian events and also turning up to the club in like full regalia, and also throwing parties at Vogue Fabrics. I mean, yeah, everything kind of intersects, so it's really hard to say, like, pinpoint, like, a moment when art came to me or when I came to art. I think, yeah, that question, it really depends on, like, what you mean by art.
Mm-hmm. And I guess, do you associate the beginnings of your artistic practice with the education that you may have had? Is that something that you think is, again, at the same time with coming to art and coming to drawing?
I think that the thing about art school, I mean, like, that is definitely when you could say that I had my engagement with, like, art with a capital A, because it was the first time that I had been kind of exposed to that context. I think that's what art school does. It teaches you about the context that you're trying to operate within. And how to contextualize yourself within that. So yeah, definitely. I think that my undergrad was the beginning to that. And then at the Royal College of Art, I was able to also like meet technicians and have facilities that have access to creative facilities that allowed me to create works that I kind of always wanted to make, like films.
Mm-hmm. So would you say that was something that was there before you enrolled in university, and then you started working with drag as part of your education as well?
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. I started doing drag before I went to secondary school. University.
Mm-hmm.
It was something that I started doing for me, really. It wasn't something that I got into my art practice until like the end of my AMA, because it was something that for me was so personal. I wanted to do it for a really long time. I first encountered drag in bars on Church Street when I was 17 years old in Toronto. But it wasn't something that I realized was like available to me, something that I could do until I encountered it again in London. And I encountered people who were doing it in a way that wasn't just about being a man pretending to be a woman. But about kind of exploring and fantasizing about like identity more broadly.
Yeah, is it fair to say that there's that kind of differentiation between how drag is perceived in that side of the Atlantic rather than the UK? You think that there was more space and liberty to bend the expectations of what drag can be when you arrived here?
Yeah, definitely. When I arrived here, like, it was the first time that I encountered people who were doing drag. It was like, it wasn't even about gender, it was like people that were being monsters. it didn't necessarily have to do with gender on either like what you were pretending to be or where you were coming from.
Mm-hmm. And you said that you also perceived drag to be something personal, so when you start embarking with drag on your education and your artistic practice, you have to consolidate these two things in a way that was meaningful to you rather than what you were doing with drag before. How did you present this idea to your own professors, for example?
I think that when I first started doing drag, it was almost this like secret thing that I was, it was like a guilty pleasure, like something that I wasn't quite ready to like even admit to myself, other than like other people that I wanted to do and like was doing. I had a tutor in my undergrad that I showed some images to because I felt comfortable enough with him. Because he was my only gay tutor. I didn't bring it into the work, but I showed him what I was doing a few times, and I think that it was kind of, he was kind of really like, that's the most exciting thing that you're doing right now. But he was the only one who seemed kind of really interested in it. But yeah, he was like, have you ever heard of Judith Butler? And I was like, yeah, who's that?
And then I guess you start reading, and obviously there's another question that I wanted to ask you about the relationship to language, because as we also see witnessed in this film, there's the language element to the practice in many ways. This is a film that has language, so let's start with your relationship to language, and then I guess your relationship to film was being just. Mm-hmm. How do you relate to language?
I think I've had like some, like many different experiences with language that have changed the way that I think. I mean, like first of all, I can talk about the fact that like growing up, there was a period where I was like often speaking three different languages. There was English, obviously, growing from Toronto. There was French. I was doing French immersion, so all of my classes were in French in elementary school, and then every day after school, and sometimes on weekends, I was at my grandparents' place speaking Cantonese. And every one of these languages, especially English and Cantonese, kind of presented like different worlds to me. Like I found that I really felt like a different person in different contexts that I was when I was speaking these different languages. And I think that's like a really common experience for people who are multilingual, that they have different experiences with themselves, and they see themselves in a different way, or they kind of have different personas, or find that they feel that they have different personas when they're speaking their different languages. So there was that, and then when I was a little bit older, I started reading science fiction. That dealt a lot with language. And so the first really good example of that was Fable 17 by Samuel Delaney. And then the second really good example of that is The Dispossessed by Ursula Le Guin. They're both authors that deal a lot with language in their writing and the kind of potentials of language. They both talk about the Sapir Whorf hypothesis, which is like a hypothesis that says that if you don't have a word for something, it makes it incredibly difficult to think about and speak about. And Fable 17 in particular is like a novel that really is all about like how language is not just something that gives shape to thought, like it shapes thought. Like, for example, if in English you are only ever used to speaking about people in gender terms, then it's really difficult to think about people in ways that are not gendered.
And you recently wrote a text that I was reading on my way here, and you were thinking about the relationship of language, gender, and technology, and you say that gender is a technology, and yes, gender is also a language, and you are describing about the limitations that you have when you are asked to think about every subject that you encounter as a gender subject, and how that relationship has changed, but it also takes quite a lot of effort to undo these bonds that we have, both in our thinking and the way that we express these encounters. So could you talk about that and the importance, I guess, of format as well?
Language is definitely technology. shifts the way that you think. So it's like incredibly powerful. I think that talking about like the whole discourse around like pronouns and gender identity is like really important here. You know, the fact that non-binary pronouns have actually been, like, they, them, has been used as a singular pronoun since Shakespearean times, but people are having a lot of difficulty now because usually it's used as, like, a placeholder when you don't know somebody's gender yet. Like, the real problem that people have in using it is not really that it's difficult to use it as a singular pronoun. The difficulty that people have with it is to keep on not gendering somebody once you think that you know their gender. And this is like the mental leap that people have to make, but you kind of, you get used to doing it. I think that I really, I didn't, like growing up, I didn't realize that non-binary gender was an option. And as soon as I encountered it in friends, people that I met in London, I was like, oh my god, definitely that, you know? And I was so struck by the way that I started to really think about these people in ungendered terms when I got used to using non-binary pronouns for them, and like what this did to the ways that I thought about them. Yeah, it was really powerful.
Mm-hmm. There's a slideshow playing behind us with pictures from different works of yours, different mediums, and like from performance to film, to some installations that are in there. And there's a focus on femininity, and I know that you have a way to approach the meaning in your work that maybe to people who haven't heard what you just described about the non-binary comes out. Can you tell us about how you approach that meaning in your work? And then how does that, so where does that sit in relation to what we talked about as an approach to the non-binary ways of seeing and feeling things?
I think that my relationship to femininity is like always changing, but it's always been like really important. When I am, like in my work, I like to work a lot with femininity, but it's really important that people recognize that it's coming from a non-binary perspective because, like for me, femininity doesn't have anything to do necessarily with womanhood. And I think it's, yeah, really important to distance like ideas of masculinity and femininity from essentialist notions of like manhood and womanhood. At the same time, there is a way that like femininity is socialized, especially for people who are assigned female at birth, who've been socialized as female. And a lot of the ways that I engage with femininity in my work, especially images of femininity, is to kind of like work through like obsessions or like attitudes or like ways that I've been taught to identify with them and embody them, or kind of fail to embody them.
And you always know, there's this, your voice in my head keeps coming back when you, there's this thing that you said in the film, where you use femininity to take up space.
Mm.
How do you do that?
So, I mean, yeah, this comes back to like being 17 and gay bars in Toronto and watching drag shows at Woody's. Like, I just remember like going and seeing a live drag show for the first time and seeing drag queens like use femininity to be like really loud and take up space. And it was like the first time that I really encountered that. And it was the first time I realized that there was like, that like femininity could be queer, and it could be used in like so many different ways, and it could be kind of embodied in so many different ways and like complicated. And that was like a really exciting prospect for me. So I think that like I'm still trying to like in my work constantly, I don't know, I think that in like previous years I've been trying to deal a lot with like an obsession with like an ideal image of especially like Western femininity. But now I'm trying to like push forward to imagine like fantasy embodiments of femininity and what that could look like and what that could feel like and what that could do.
Mm-hmm. How is the embodiment of femininity different from, let's say, your performance work to your film work that we just watched?
I'm not sure if the embodiment of femininity is different, but the consumption of it is definitely. I mean, within film, like you're using the language of cinema to talk about systems of looking that have been constructed within cinema, which is really useful. And it's completely different from sitting in a live performance and having this kind of energy and dynamic with a live performer. I mean, both mediums are about storytelling for me, but they're just doing these things in incredibly different ways. I mean, there are like technologies within both performance and film. That just do completely different things.
Mm. There was like this long shot in the film that we just watched where it starts from the heel and then it goes up to the body. And
yeah.
Maybe you don't realize that it's actually something that is quite common in Hollywood films, for example, to just approach bodies in that way.
Yeah.
And there are interesting connections to the titles in your work. How do you title your work? For example, this one is called Narrative, Reflections of Looking, and there's another one. Tell me everything you saw and what you think it means. Mm-hmm. It's also connected to a cinematic history. Do you want to talk about that thing?
Definitely. So, yeah, Narrative Reflections on Looking is the title of the series. The part one is titled She Was More Than the Sum of My Parts. Titles for me are like, they're often really long. I don't know, like, sometimes I feel like I'm being a bit extra with the titles, but, like, I think that they're a really nice way to, like, give people an in, like, a really immediate in to, like, the ways that I'm thinking. I think, yeah, they're really important because often people look at my work and they are, like, confronted with the images first, so much so that, like, the kind of the narrative is, like, overlooked. So, in titles, I'm often trying to, like, add this first immediate layer of like a feeling or research. So, I mean, Tell Me Everything You Saw and What You Think It Means is a quote from Rear Window, which is a, you know, the famous Hitchcock film where it's all about voyeurism and this guy who's looking and trying to figure out this kind of murder mystery through his back window, where the real object of the gaze in the entire film is Grace Kelly. So the fact that she is asking Patrick Stewart, like, tell me everything you saw and what you think it means, is like actually like really heavily ironic, because everybody is really just looking at her.
Yeah.
And
I guess there's this, I want to go back again, I think we're always going to go back to this, your relationship to language, but what is also your relationship to the image? Because also in the film that we watched, we were talking about her, but this her in quotation marks fluctuates between the person who we might be watching, but also this her can be the image itself.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you relate to images?
I think the her, I use her and she a lot in my work, and I think that it's supposed to be a very like uncertain like positionality, whether it's like the kind of the narrator or the image, like where the voice is kind of coming from. My relationship to images, I mean, my relationship to images sparked both my drag work and my writing. I mean, before I started doing drag, I would spend like hours on Tumblr just like saving images that I came across that like I was really obsessed with. They were mostly images of like really glamorous white woman in pop culture. And yeah, I would save these images and like continue to revisit these images that I really wasn't really sure like why I was so compelled towards them. I wasn't sure if like I wanted to be the images or fuck the images or just be close to the images, and in the end it, like drag was a way for me to kind of, it was like somewhere in between. And it was also like through the experience of like looking at images of myself in drag and trying to figure out like what that was all about that I started writing. And the film that you saw was the first like fictional narrative that I wrote that I included in my work. And everything has kind of continued from there.
Speaking of images and being at the course of what is your relationship to art history?
Oh my gosh. That's your job.
Are there any artists that you look up to or you remember from your education journey or even outside of your education journey?
I think that's really difficult. Like, I spent a lot of my education journey being really frustrated with my tutors because it was like, I was never really guided in the right path. Like, I feel like all of the artists that I came to who I really loved were people that I really went out and like found myself. I remember going to the Live Art Development Agency and watching some clips of Castles perform.
Powerful.
Yeah, very powerful. How they, the body images, how they think of their bodies as sculpture. Just the ways in which they kind of like dissect image making and embody images. Shui Chen was like a really important discovery for me, something that I only came to in my MA. And actually the first work that I saw of hers was her feature length science fiction porno called IKU. And I was at the time writing a dissertation that was about kind of what science fiction narratives could do in queer pornography and how they could kind of undo and like recreate narratives within science that essentialize gender and bodies in really violent ways for queer people. So yeah, when I encountered her work, I was like, where has this person been? But to be honest, like for the most part, the people that have really inspired me in my work, like I think that I really like found my art practice when I started reading science fiction again. Like I always did as a kid, and then I became aware of like how cripplingly uncool it was. And then I stopped really unfortunately, and then I only came back to it pretty much in my undergrad. But I started reading some really important authors like Samuel Delaney and Octavia Butler and Ursula Le Guin, who are using it to like speak more accurately about the kind of socio-political situations that we are in than nonfiction ever could.
Absolutely, and you relate science fiction directly to queer resistance. You want to talk about that?
Yeah, definitely. So I also encountered around the same time this book called Octavia's Brood by Adrienne Marie Brown. It's an anthology edited by Walida Emerisha and Adrienne Marie Brown that basically asked leaders of social justice movements to write science fiction, and these were people who were like not necessarily authors, but they wanted people who knew about kind of like struggles within social justice to use their knowledge to imagine what a better world would look like and feel like, and give people the opportunity to immerse themselves in those worlds. And I think that that really opened me up to the power of like fantasy and science fiction. And I realized that that was what I wanted my work to do. And that was also the power of like drag. Like I think about drag like embodied speculative fiction. fiction, you know, embodying these fantasy narratives. And I think there's a real power in that you can kind of create and like realize fantasy narratives. I mean, for me, that happened with me for drag, like during drag, and embodying these fantasy gender and identity positionalities, I realized I wasn't a woman. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just one example of how like fantasy and like living fantasy has changed me.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is also
true
for a lot of other people.
Absolutely. And there are other artists, I would say, I guess your peers, that are also using science fiction as a strategy of unbinding these narratives that are tied to heteronormativity, I guess. And I was just thinking, well, actually, we were talking before we started speaking publicly in this lecture room about something that Jack Halderson mentioned the other day, a great queer theorist and professor, he was saying, what about thinking of science fiction in that capacity as something that can be a utopian promise rather than focusing on the present and the struggles that we are facing in the present, rather than projecting always to a future that is a promise that you might not be able to fulfill the promise or experience the future because we're all going to be extinct or something. But do you think that kind of striking shifting and embodiment of science fiction in one's practice carries a utopian aspect to it, or is it something that is more open-ended?
I think that it definitely is something that is more open-ended. But I do think that, I don't believe in utopias, and I think like other science fiction authors are aware that utopias don't exist. I mean, that is like the definition of utopia. I think it's really, you know, there's hopeful science fiction though, and I think that's really important because you need to have like images, hopeful images, to move towards, or to work towards. I think that, there's like some really important science fiction novels that have changed the way that I think don't create like that don't necessarily have like the binary of like utopia and dystopia. Some of them deal with like heterotopias. You know, like in The Dispossessed, you're presented with like two twin planets. One is anarcho-syndicalist and the other one is capitalist. And like neither one is utopian. I would say that almost like both of them are more dystopian. Mm-hmm. But by reading the book, you have a feeling of what it would feel like to live in both societies. Or, I mean, you have a kind of an outsider's perspective of what it's like to live in a capitalist society. Mm-hmm. And then there's like a whole, Samuel Delaney wrote a novel which like responded to that novel, where in every world there are like districts where there are no laws, and he like explores how this would change people's attitudes towards crime and the penal system.
I guess I just want to also think about with you, how can we use science fiction? Yes, I can see the ways that we can use science fiction to imagine a different future. How can we use science fiction to start to imagine a different present? And how, I guess, your performances might be able to do something like that.
So I think, one of the most powerful things that speculative fiction can do is it can give you a different perspective of like what is actually going on by using metaphors of like aliens for otherness, or like space operas and in place of wars, or you know, like for me, for example, reading Bible 17 was it was not a novel about an alien language. It was a novel about the English language, and it made me kind of think about how. You know, like language is a reflection of culture. that stream for every language, not only verbal but also visual, even bodily language. And that, like, if we're shaped by language, which is shaped by histories in which it's created, then there's also a way to shape language to change the way that you think.
Mm-hmm. How do you approach the script for performance? Where does it start?
Totally depends.
I want to give the example that is also the title of our conversation today. Inarticulate Depths is something that is a line from this guy as an image, Bazanet, which is the performance that they created there at the Serpentine for organizing 2018. And it goes like, this guy is an image, is an net to keep us from falling from inarticulate depths. So, again, there's always this connection to language and image, but it is something that is also, I guess, a state of being in your performances. Your performances, both through the script and in the long pauses that you often sometimes employ, bring us to inarticulate depths that can be, again, for me, I think, as resistant as language can be.
Pauses are very important. But the writing it often starts from like incredibly personal experiences. The performance, tell me everything you saw. Not tell me everything you saw. If I had the words to tell you, we wouldn't be here now. Some of which the images have been flashing up on the screen. They came from really personal experiences of like struggling to communicate with people around me. Especially in this like incredibly polarizing time that we're living in. Talking to people that I loved about how things that they were saying were dehumanizing for me and people that I love. There was kind of like an impossibility of being able to express emotions clearly in a way that didn't halt the conversation. And I realized that, the way that language is constructed is like, in order to problem solve, in order to communicate, you know, you often need to be rational about things. And I was kind of really against this binary of like thinking and feeling, like actually, why can't they be the same thing? Mm-hmm. Being able to kind of like communicate clearly any thoughts that were like truly like feminist or queer or post-colonial with this language that was produced within the histories of colonialism, patriarchy, capitalism. It came out of a frustration, so I started writing from that point. But I often, I'll start with something that is really personal and then abstract it through a lens of fantasy and speculative fiction in order to make it kind of more universal, something that everyone can identify with. Because I think these are experiences that everyone can identify with.
For example, in A View from Elsewhere, A View from Elsewhere is also a book, and that book is also the script for our performance that you presented. Some of the images are in the auditorium and when you from the theater of the Venice Triangle. You've done it in Cafe Oro as well. But I really remember both the incredible depths of language that you fall into, and you ask your audience also to fall into. But also there are moments where there's no language at all, and again, it's another kind of, I guess, unendurance test for your audience. So there are different strategies that are at play there, and I was just thinking, if there's a sense of resistance in that, you are undermining the expectations of your audience, and when they come into the theater, and they're expecting to see a correct performance.
Yeah, they're expecting like an languages that they're used to. Yeah, I mean, often I use language with the absence of it to, you know, like in the Serpentine Park Nights performance, there was like a moment where I just stood still for 5 minutes. I think, yeah, it's really important to challenge the ways that people are used to consuming images mm-hmm. in order to make a question how they consume images.
And bodies.
And bodies, yeah, definitely. In everyday context.
How does that differ from where you've designed the brand, from nightclubs to the Serpentine to the biennial, where different registers? Like, I remember also seeing you perform with Sasha Valor and RuPaul Drag Queens. So that was super fun, but it was a completely different context you've seen.
It was a really different context. I think that there are like different expectations and different ways of looking that come with different contexts. It's really important to be aware of those things and to use those things to your benefit as an artist. So, I mean, like in a drag context, in a cabaret context or like a kind of a queer nightclub context, that people are there mostly to be entertained and maybe a little bit too critical. Whereas in an art context, you know, people are more willing to like sit with you while you stand still for 5 minutes. Or, you know, you present an hour-long performance. I mean, in drag context, with the performance that I do, the performances that I do are really different. They're like, you know, 5 minutes tops. And actually, there's usually no speaking at all in them. The one that I'm most known for is making a sandwich on stage to music.
I went for the past 5 minutes of my life. Okay, I guess I remember also reading in an interview that you said that you're doing less of drag performances in nightclubs and queer spaces because you feel that you always have to prove that you belong there?
Well, it's a very different context. I think that there is definitely like a glass ceiling in queer drag context. And I think I hit it. And then in our context, I was offered different opportunities to make different works and explore, you know, like my writing and just different ways of creating performance, and that was really exciting to me. So yeah, I mean, it's not that I look down on the context that I came up with in. You know, those were really important to me.
How has your relationship to materiality changed over the years? But I feel like that is something that you don't ask necessarily a lot. There's this word fan bag that I really love that was the bag with the
relationship
size.
Yeah, fan bag.
And then, of course, the relationship to materials in every single performance changes. Different costumes, different settings. You're working with lighting design as well as material as well. So, How do you relate to materials?
I think that there are kind of two main ways that I relate to, or that I use materiality in my work. I think that the first way is through like costuming and lighting and like makeup, and you know, like you can see I'm using materials that are made to be shown and often not like up close to be glamorous. And so there's like very much a materiality that is a reflection of like the construction of ideal images within consumer capitalism. Mm-hmm. The second way that I've been exploring it is through writing. Often when I'm writing a piece, I'm like staying for a long time in a moment, or I'm trying to kind of like make you feel what it is like to be in this moment with me. And when I'm writing, I'll often like close my eyes and really try to use all of the different descriptive words that I can so that you can feel exactly what I'm trying to make you feel.
Yeah, and you mentioned something about a newfound interest in Taoism. You want to talk about that?
Yeah, definitely.
to ask that question. How do you queer the art museum?
Oh my god. I think that's a really hard question. I don't even know if it's like completely possible. I think that the first thing that you can do is like hire queer curators and art directors to put on shows that are about queerness, or even that are not about queerness. Like, imagine that. Yeah, it's like you have, you know, the infrastructure itself is not queer. Like, how do you queer the infrastructure before you, not just by throwing in queer artists, definitely. And that has been like a really unfortunate experience that I've had several times in the past few years. I think that, I don't know, but also it's like really maybe impossible. Like, there's this thing about like trying to change, like, can you ever really change the institution? Like, the institution is like intrinsically like built out of, again, like histories of colonialism and patriarchy and capitalism. So can it ever really truly be like queer or feminist? Is it not always going to be violent towards these people?
Yeah.
I don't know, I think that like the best way to figure around that as an artist is to like do artist-led projects in spaces that are not institutions. I mean, that's where my dream-based project came out of. It was about like organizing things myself with people that I know and love in spaces that were more DIY and like not institutionalized, in order to be able to have different conversations and different settings and just different energies.
Yeah, I guess community plays a role in that. What do you think is important? I don't know, about the sense of community in London today, or not just London, across the world.
It's really vital. It's like a survival tactic for artists, people that are marginalized. Yeah, and I think I would have gone insane by now if I didn't have a support network that was like my community.
What are you working on now? What's coming up next?
Okay, so right now I'm working on a new hour-long performance which will be presented at the Guggenheim in New York in May. It's very exciting. And yeah, it has a lot to do with I started reading and exploring Taoist philosophy last year, and this is the first time that I'm really like bringing it into the work in a real way, because it solidifies so many things that I've been thinking about in terms of like gender and binaries and false dichotomies, and reading it from like a non-binary perspective. You know, I'm thinking about a non-binary perspective as a way to like contain multitudes within yourself, as a way to like challenge the act of naming, as a way to kind of like savor like the constant transformation of things and really like revel in it.
Mm-hmm. You often say that naming is a mastery.
Yeah, naming is an act of mastery. It's true. Like as humans are like our intellect functions off of like pattern recognition. We're always trying to categorize things so that we can understand them. But really, you know, it's impossible to understand everything. Like, we'd like to think that we know everything, but we just know nothing. But if we ever really are like confronted with that fact, like there's so much discomfort. And a lot of this performance is about like sitting in the discomfort and sitting outside of categories. And undoing kind of man's need to name and to create these binaries And within this passage, there is a questioning of like whether he is a human dreaming he's a butterfly, or a butterfly dreaming that he's a human. And there's kind of like a dividing within this experience. So the performance is set up as a dream, trying to present the experience of the senses of the dream. There's everything that we know and how we came to know it as a dream, in which there's potential for waking.
Beautiful. I think we are ready to open up and take questions.
Thank you. Thanks to the guests for preparing such thoughtful questions. A lot of them that I wanted to ask you then asked, which is a bit perspective-sizing, so go on. So thank you, and thanks, Victoria, for giving such eloquent answers and thoughtful, interesting answers. One of the questions I have is, Victoria mentioned that you left science fiction behind for a bit and then you came back to it later. Why do you think you came back to it? Something that I've noticed, I think, in contemporary art recently is more and more artists are turning their attention to science fiction, and science fiction is a mode of telling and showing. I'm just intrigued to know why you came back to it.
I can't remember. Oh, yeah, okay. So the reason why I came back to it is because in my undergrad I was told to read the Cyborg Manifesto. And the Cyborg Manifesto is like a really beautiful essay, like weaving a science fiction construction into theory. And that is like a really great example for me of like how science fiction can be used to change the way you think, to, to be a productive medium within theory. I think like so much of theory is about critique. And actually this was like a really exciting proposition to be able to like create things that I wanted to be or wanted to be immersed in. And the Cyborg Manifesto also led me to Octavia Butler and to Ursula Le Guin and the carryback theory of fiction, and that's basically where it started.
Thank you.
Hi. Thank you again. Amazing. You were talking a bit about. You were talking about how the binary of like thinking and feeling, and how you disagreed with it, and that really like struck me. I was just like, why can't it be the same thing? And I was like, I have never questioned that binary. And I was wondering whether you could talk a bit more about that.
So, I mean, within culture, I think like being like rational is really valued, and being irrational is. I mean, rationality and irrationality is also like set up as a binary that also is tied to like, irrationality is tied to femininity also. And I think, it's really important to like undo these binaries, but I think as I said, like language is something that reflects the power structures in which it was created, and those are definitely patriarchy, colonialism, and capitalism, and so like the ways that we're taught to speak and like express ourselves are ways that like vilify emotion, and it's emotions are like one of the most human things possible. So to be told that you have to express yourself while completely suppressing this like really important experience that actually really informs our ideas and the ways that we move through the world is like super violent. So, yeah, I think, like, for example, in my my performance, if I had the words to tell you, we wouldn't be here now. I'm using language to try to deconstruct language, which is, like, you know, an impossible thing. So what I do is I take away some words and some sentences, and I work with an instrumentalist who will then replace those words with notes or musical sentences. And the reason why I do that is because I think language is, like, a much more eloquent way to express emotions that are, like, incredibly complex. And to also try to resist naming. Yeah, I mean, I don't have an answer, but I think that it's really important to realize that actually they're the same thing, and that feeling has everything to do with thinking. Feeling is thinking.
Thank you. That's really sparked my curiosity. I've been thinking about that all now.
I think that, I mean, like, some discourses are, like, really advanced in certain contexts, but there are still people who, like, don't understand that being gay and being trans are different things. I think that, I don't know, I mean, there's been a lot of exhibitions that have been done in the past few years, but even those exhibitions, like, are often, like, on, like, a very kind of, like, we're just getting started.
And I think that it's important for that, I think, to be part of a wider dialogue. And what I enjoy in visiting the genders exhibition at King's College and the Science Gallery is that there was an advisory committee or board that you were part of, I think.
Yeah.
And it was an interesting approach to see that that was set in place rather than a single voice authoring the whole thing.
Yeah, and a single voice authoring an exhibition in the Science Gallery about gender is a very dangerous thing, or it could be a very dangerous thing. I mean, the people who are curating and running the Science Gallery are all white and cis, so I thought it was really good, actually, that they invited people in with different experiences that could, you know, help them to frame conversations around gender, and how complex they are, and how they are intrinsically intertwined with other identity categories. and totally inseparable from them. Yeah, I mean, I think the exhibition at the Science Gallery was, I mean, because there was an advisory board and we had so many meetings, and there were so many people who were coming from all these different perspectives. You know, even though they were so careful about it and made sure they were really informed about it, there's still things that you know, I would have done differently. But again, like, I also shouldn't be the only person making decisions. But they were really like open to listening, which I think is like a really powerful thing that an institution can do. Yeah, I think it can, especially in the Science Museum. You know, like, there is so much potential, like, narratives around science and gender are so violent to queer people, especially trans people. So I think that they were aware of that potential.
Talk about gender in a different way, and how gender is not represented in a sort of grammatical way in some languages. So, to make an example, I'm thinking like in Italian, every single word is gendered.
Mm-hmm.
In German, it's the same, but in Italian, you say that the sun is masculine, while in German, it's feminine. And in English, there's no gender for the sun. Well, for example, in Farsi, in Persian language, you don't have gender for a third person, you just have who. How do you think about mixing different languages, or do you think this can have a different approach to how people think and look up visual language as well?
Yeah, definitely. I think that, some languages are more gendered than others, and some cultures are more gendered than others, and usually you can kind of get a little bit of a hint from that from the language. In terms of, I'm not sure what you mean by like mixing languages, but I think that there is potential for changing languages. I mean, there's like often a lot of uproar about people who want to purposefully change language, but language is constantly changing. But while we're kind of realizing that things need to change, or in ways that when we become aware of like how systems of power are reflected in language. You know, like you can, like, so many words that like name people that have to do with like colonial histories, like we've realized are really wrong. And we change things. So, you know, like there's an awareness now of like person-first language, where, you know, instead of saying, a disabled person, you say someone who is disabled, for example. But then even within those communities, there's kind of a discussion about reclaiming certain words. Language is always transforming, and I think it's really important to be open to that.
Hi. I wanted to ask a bit if you want to talk a bit more about the aspect of fragility in your work, because I've seen your exhibition, but your show at the RCA, and then I came to the Hayward, and it was like I need to be recognizing suddenly this massive projection on this very soft fabric, which felt very intimate, even though it was so big. And just wanted to see if you can talk a bit more about that. This level of can be taken away very quickly, but also can be so monumental.
That's interesting. I think that I've never really thought about my work in terms of fragility, but I think about intimacy a lot. Like how to connect, how to make it seem like the work and the viewer are like the only things in the world at that moment. I don't know, I think that, again, my way of doing that is usually to start from experiences that are like really intensely personal. And then change them or do something to them and then show them to other people. Yeah, I mean, I think
it's also something that relates to what you've said as an inherent sense of playfulness within drag and your practice, which also involves science fiction, and find playfulness in science fiction as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that you've presented work in that kind of environment with that fabric that is playful as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that that's something that is underlying a lot of environments that you create in your work.
Definitely. And I think it also, again, has to do with this kind of thing with like thinking and feeling, like in my narratives. I think in general, like I can't remember who this famous quote is by, but like, you know, people will not remember what you say, they'll remember how you make them feel. And so, you know, writing in the work, I'm always trying to use like narratives and materials in order to like make people feel.
Intersection between like drag and contemporary art, like, but you kind of progressed naturally from going to drag gay clubs in Toronto, in Canada, and like going to art school. So, yeah. Sorry, was that clear?
So, what was the question?
Yeah, how is your work was being seen within the drag community, and like, did you encounter any discrimination being a bio queen, female drag queen?
So yeah, I prefer just the word just drag queen. I don't really like to use like bio queen, because that infers that like femininity is biological in any way, and I don't identify as a female. I mean, to answer your question, the drag community's been, well, I mean, the people that I chose to surround myself with when I was primarily functioning in like queer kind of club and theater contexts, like, they're all incredibly supportive. Yeah, I mean, the people who are unsupportive are the people who've always been unsupportive. But I'm not trying to make work for those people.
Thank you.
And I think the last thing that I also want to bring up is that you have this relationship to Facebooks that become objects after this performance. How do you see, again, that materiality? And what is that moment?
I mean, for me, that moment is like, it's become like a really important process for me. And again, this thing of like, it's a really important part of like putting on and taking off the embodiment. And I think it is an object that really embodies that transformation. For me, it's just really important because